No.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Retreat coming up. Can you speak about that, please?
A marvelous retreat.
But it's only for the ladies.
Only for the girls.
Lavender Spring Spa. I'm really excited about all of you that are coming. There are 16 women coming, so plus me and Howie, the man who has to do the work because he's the food man. So, yep, that's this weekend. So please come between 6 and 6:30. We're going to start at 7. So we want to be ready, but you can check into your rooms and stuff at 6. You can also sign up for massages because Angie, not Lasacco. What is it?
Churchins.
Whatever that was. I don't have my ears in. I forgot them. She's going to be doing massages, so you'll sign up for massages when you come in and register. Yeah. It's going to be really cool. We're going to decorate again, so it's going to be really fun. So I'm really excited about it. So and we even have 3 young people coming, so that's really good.
Our youth group, yeah. Yeah. Step here. So also, on March 1st, we have Ash Wednesday service here at 7 o'clock. And we're going to most likely have a wonderful video. Is that right?
Well, there might be a video. Yeah, I think there is. I've been working on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday already, so there's some cool stuff that's coming up. On the back of your bulletin, I put the schedule of everything for all of Lent into Easter so that you'll have it, so that you'll know. Ash Wednesday is March 1st, and then our Lent and Bible study starts. Did you hold this
one?
Yes,
yep, yep, yep.
Thank you. This is our Bible study. It's called Jesus' Final Week. It goes through the 7 days of the last week from the triumphal entry into the Good Friday day, and so that'll work us into Easter. So it's going to be really good. I've purchased this copy, so I'm going to make copies for everybody. So here's the pretty copy, and you just need to sign up on the back so that I can get binders and make enough copies for you. So I would encourage you all to attend. This one's pretty easy. It'll get you thinking, but it's not as heavy as some of the other ones that we've done, so please come. It's really fun. Soup suppers, because Cher's going to coordinate that. She said she would. 6:30, soup supper. 7 o'clock, we'll start the Bible study.
Yes.
I think that's all.
Excellent stuff. Thanks a lot, Victoria, for your work. And also keep in mind that any Bible study you can get into beyond just what happens Sunday morning, wherever it is, doesn't have to be sponsored by the gathering, is extremely important. That extra hour will help you with your spiritual growth. Mucho. March 4th, we have a game day at 7 on March 4th. Right here.
March 4th is game day. Bring your grandkids, bring your mom and dad. We're going to have bingo. We're going to have cards for peanut gold poker. Those guys might gamble. Bring your own pennies. Anybody who has a game that they would like to bring, my cat. Anything, you know, especially you want to play that you're thinking about.
Twister.
Twister.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
We're going to have pizza and pop and snacks. So I encourage you all to come. And
March 4th, Saturday. Yeah.
It'll be from 12 until 3 o'clock right here. So hope to see you.
And also, the Gathering North had a good experience at the Red Fair. We had our first pizza night. With the residents, that was this past Sunday, so it went well, and I think it's probably going to continue for the months to come. We're on the last Sunday of each month. We'll go to Medicare, which is a nursing facility, and invite the residents and bring in some pizza and have a good time. So that's kind of cool. All right, anything else? Yep. Lady in pink.
Yeah. We come to worship God, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We gather as the people of God, called by the gospel of Jesus Christ to the life of witness and service.
We are the people of God in this world. We are the church of Christ on earth. We are people moved by the Holy Spirit to build a world of light and hope.
Let us pray. Holy God, you gave the law to show your people the way of righteousness. Help us receive your commandments as grace and live as your obedient children, that your goodness may shine through us to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
My Jesus. Today we confess that we are not worthy of your love and ask you to forgive the sin of every area of our life. We desire a new sensitivity to the larger world around us. Open our hearts so we may hear their voices. Open our eyes so we may see their agony. Open our minds so we may understand their needs. Open our hearts so we may become involved.
Lord God is a great God and has forgiven our sin to set us free. Out of God's great love for us, Jesus died on the cross and rose on the third day, so the gap between us and God could be closed. Out of great love for us, God provides for our every need in daily life. Out of great love for us, God gives us the power to respond to the needs of those around us and giving us a new desire to serve. Out of great love for us, our sins were forgiven. We are free. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
So let us share the peace with one another.
The first lesson is from the 58th chapter of Isaiah. Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers, and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose a day to humble myself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of justice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homeless poor into your house, when you see them naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of God shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." The second lesson is from the second chapter of 1 Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages of our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also, no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. Hear and bless us. Please stand for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew chapter 5. Now you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. And you are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lamp stand and gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. So yesterday I had the privilege of going to breakfast with a friend of mine, Rich, who is still an ELCA pastor, and I've known Rich since 1982 when I first went to confirmation with him. And so we're pretty much the same age. I think we're exactly the same age, 65. So we were just kind of reminiscing about how things were about 50 years ago, okay? Back in 1967 when the Cultural Revolution began as a result of, you know, a lot of protests against the Vietnam War, what kind of started the ball rolling. And and I said to him, you know what, you know, a couple of years before 1965, the Vietnam War was still kind of considered to be a credible war. Because I remember one of my buddies that I worked with at the IGA food liner right there in Elk Grove Village by the Elk Grove Bowl at the corner of Arlington Heights and Higgins there. That was my first real job in Chicago, and I think I was around 15 or 16 years old. But his name was Stanley. Stanley Gaedig. And all Stanley would talk about was he wanted to become a Marine. He wanted to become a Marine and how to shoot a gun so he could go shoot some commies in Vietnam. That's all he talked about, yeah. So that he could protect our nation against communism, you know, our basic rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's all Stanley Gaedig talked about. But he was a little older than I. And a couple of, years went by, and then one day I walked into work and I didn't see Stanley there, and I asked the boss, where did Stanley go? And he said, well, Stanley went to join the Marines. That's all I know. And that was the last we ever heard of Stanley Gaedig. I mean, I have no idea what happened to this guy. As far as I know, he might have lost his life in Vietnam, but he did have this goal of, protecting our country and its basic rights against the commies, you know, our pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you know, that's what his main goal was. So you go up about 50 years to 2017, and for some people the story is the same. Some of you may have remembered just about a week ago a young man named Ryan Owens. Did you see his picture in the news? From Illinois. Ryan Owens was a typical kid at Illinois Valley Central High School, fun-loving, solid student athlete, and respectful to adults. One element of his personality distinguished him from many others in his class, however. From his freshman year, the kid known as O-Dog talked often about becoming a Navy SEAL, a member of the elite, rugged, combat unit, and yet on Saturday, I think it was last Saturday, Owens, at the age of 36, originally from Peoria, was killed in Yemen. That's down at the southern part of the Arabian Peninsula during a raid against the Al-Qaeda. He played baseball and football and competed in all, on those teams for the Illinois Valley Central Grey Ghosts. Owens also enjoyed fishing and deer hunting around Chillicothe, the Illinois River town about 140 miles southwest of Chicago. Huh?
Chillicothe.
Chillicothe? Yeah. Chillicothe. Chillicothe. Sorry. Owens lived in Chillicothe, or what do you want to call it, during high school. And he graduated in May of 1998 and enlisted in Navy in the August of that year. And according to his commander, Owens was an exceptional SEAL, an experienced warrior, and a highly respected teammate who served silently, nobly, and bravely through several combat deployments. Ryan's legacy strengthens our own resolve and commitment to this crucial fight. We hope his family can find support and comfort in the love of family, friends, and teammates. Owens also earned 3 Bronze Stars, and he was on his 12th deployment. It's amazing. And the raid that he participated in left 30 other militants dead, and plus I guess they got a lot of knowledge, you know, from what they captured. But here's a young man, you know, just like Stanley Gaedic, who wanted to protect, you know, our basic rights, you know, of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and did so by giving his life. And it goes to show you how important those rights are that are part of our Declaration of Independence and supported by the Constitution. I mean, many people over the years have literally given their life and fought the good fight so that we can experience those basic rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness every day. When you think about it, how fortunate we are. And that's what makes this country so unique. And it's kind of ironic because Quinn, one of our youth leaders, was speaking about this on Thursday, this past Thursday, when we had our youth worship. He was talking about how blessed we are in this country to be able to have basic rights and all the material blessings that we have. And yet at the same time, he also said how blessed we are as disciples of Jesus, as followers of Christ, as warriors for his kingdom, to be blessed by certain spiritual truths that God makes available to us, and how we need as American believers to pursue those spiritual truths and be welcoming of them in addition to the many gifts we have given to us by this nation. That we are given a lot of physical things by this country, but we're also called to pursue the spiritual truths that are made available to us through Jesus Christ. So I found that to be kind of a neat thing. I went up to him after his sermon and said, you know, that's pretty neat. Because sometimes we as Americans get so dulled and into our materialism that we forget what is truly important, which is the spiritual ramifications of what Christ has to offer. You know, studies have shown that people in other countries that don't have much material wealth to kind of cloud the picture and pursue the spiritual dynamics a whole lot more heartily than we sometimes, as Americans, who get all bogged up in the materialism, pursue what God has to offer us. So that was kind of a neat thing. And yesterday, in addition to meeting Rich, I also had the privilege around lunchtime to go to a worship service, an Arabic worship service for recent immigrants. I was invited by Art. Some of you know Art from the Gathering North. And it was held at Prince of Peace Lutheran Church on Butterfield, right there in Lombard. You can see it along the road. But it's an Arabic worship service in English. They both speak both. and it's for recent refugees and immigrants who speak the Arabic language, who come to this worship service to learn a little bit more about who Jesus is. And it's amazing because what they talked about was how blessed we are in this country and why they come here for those basic rights of life, liberty, and a pursuit of happiness, that you can live freely and pursue your hopes and dreams. And that's why people try to get into this country. And then they said, but in addition to that, remember that Jesus gives us a whole new spiritual blessings as well that can be offered to you in addition to the many blessings that this country has to offer. And you can practice those things freely, those spiritual blessings. So they're letting people know that in addition to their search for the physical blessings that this country has to offer, they can also tap into the spiritual blessings that Jesus has to offer as well, and in many ways experience the blessings in both dimensions. And I found that to be pretty cool. I mean, that's what they talked about during the worship service, both in Arabic and in English. So there's some real witnessing going out there to the people from all different types of faith, but amazing many Muslims who speak the Arabic language. So I found that to be really neat, because basically what we have in our gospel lesson for today, when Jesus is doing the Sermon on the Mount, which is what we're going to be in for quite a while, in Matthew, he's, to me, it's kind of like a declaration of independence by Jesus, where he basically says, folks, the time is now where I'm declaring to you that you now have made available to you some spiritual truths, some spiritual things that you can tap into and get a hold of to lead more of a spiritual life. And that is spiritual freedom. And that is the power over sin, death, and the devil. And that is eternal joy. These things are now made available to you. When you read the Sermon on the Mount, that's kind of the undergirding declaration by Jesus that something brand new is being made available to all of humanity that goes beyond just the physical things that we pursue. And he's saying to people, pursue these spiritual things. Allow these blessings to become part of your life. I've made them available to you, free of charge, so that you in turn can share those blessings and enlighten the world. Move some of the darkness out of your life. Move some of the darkness out of other people's lives. And you can salt the earth in a good way. Salt is a good thing when it's used in a good manner. You can flavor the world around you. You now have the power to impact your family, your friends, your workplace, your neighborhood, even the team that you coach, in a way that God sees fit. You're blessed to be a blessing. And you can do it freely and openly in this country. That's what's so doubly amazing. We need to take advantage of that, folks. But we have to humbly admit that we are in need of those blessings, and we have to humbly serve Christ in administering these blessings to the world around us. Powerful stuff when you think about it. Now, when I was standing there waiting for that Arabic worship service to start, I was talking to this lady, and she was telling me about a pastor here in Chicago who chose to do an internship, a year-long internship, by taking his wife and his family down into a part of Chicago where a lot of Arabic refugees live from these countries, you know. And it's usually not the best places, okay? She did kind of describe, you know, the living conditions that this man chose for he and his two children and his wife, because he felt called to go down there and live among the refugees for a year to help enlighten their world. I mean, they're already being enlightened to some extent by the basic Declaration of Independence that this country stands for. But he also wanted to enlighten them through the new Declaration of Independence that Jesus Christ gives by being a light amidst their darkness. And she described to me how this man went down there amongst these horrible living conditions and spent a whole year helping these refugees do very simple things like driver's license, helping with medications, letters of recommendation, helping to interpret, you know, simple things like bank accounts, you know, things that you and I kind of take for granted, but when you come to this country, is often difficult to understand. And so that's how Christ wants us to be. Doesn't mean we have to go down to Chicago and live amongst refugees. We've got enough work to be done right there in our own home. Don't we? You might be just living with your spouse or with your kids. Nothing personal, but that's where the work needs to be done. It might be the person that you're working with. Is that right? It might be the people that you're working with. So instead of succumbing to the darkness, why don't you choose to ask God to give you the knowledge and the power to be a force of enlightenment? It might mean a change in your attitude, a change in your behavior, a change in which you perceive things and why you're there in that particular situation. Because oftentimes God puts us in difficult situations precisely because that difficult situation needs to be changed. And maybe you're the one that needs to be the one to become a change agent. Not the one to succumb and complain like everybody else. Everybody can do that. So last night, I was kind of relaxing because I've been kind of dealing with the cold. And my wife's not home, so I go through the movie channels.
Which movie channel?
Yeah, just through movie channels. Well, not that stars. And you know, I've gone through the movie channel so many times that my thing doesn't work sometimes. Not my controller, but the actual unit. But anyway, that's just the way I am. So I'm going through the movie channels and boom! What pops up? But Risen. You know? And it's precisely where Claudius, the Roman tribune, who saw Jesus die on the cross and has been pursuing the resurrected Jesus, is actually bursting open the door because he's been told where the resurrected Jesus is by some informant along with his disciples. And he bursts open the door and he's got his sword in his hand. And he sees the resurrected Jesus smiling and laughing with his disciples, sharing a meal, and he is just totally overwhelmed by the resurrected power that he sees in front of him, that he drops his sword. And you hear the clanging of the sword on the ground. And it's the last time that Claudius, a powerful, brutal Roman tribune, ever picks up the sword again. Talk about a declaration of independence. Because even though he knew he had to do this work, he often talked about the day when he would be liberated from having to brutally kill people every day. And boom! You could just see it in his eyes. Joseph Fiennes, I think is his name, the guy who plays that role, that Italian actor. And from that moment on, he's a changed person. Completely changed by the power of the resurrected Jesus. And that's a lot that they talked about to these immigrants, that we have a Jesus that's alive. No other religion can claim that. He is alive, and you have to let that aliveness become part of your very heart. You may know it all, but it doesn't become real knowledge till you accept that aliveness in your heart. And that's what happened to Claudius. That moment he opened that door, whoa, it hit his heart. And the movie ends with the other disciples going their own way after Jesus ascends, and Claudius going back to where he came from to become a light amidst the darkness, to become a new salt, to salt the world powerfully. And so once, I had to watch the rest of the movie, you know, from that moment. And then once it was over, then the up-and-coming attractions came on, and guess what's going to come this year but Hacksaw Ridge, which I saw last year. Great movie. I'm going to tell you about it. You should have seen it already. Don't worry about it. It's my privilege. If you're more worried about that than the message, then you got a problem. Anyway, Hacksaw Ridge, you know, it's about a man of conscientious objection, and he wants to go fight during World War II, but he refuses to pick up a gun, Desmond Doss, because of his faith. He refuses to pick up a gun. And because of that, he's ridiculed and persecuted, but he chooses instead to become a medic. And, you know, everybody's saying, well, you know, what a Johan and all this stuff. But then comes the Battle of Okinawa, where his infantry division is, they have to take over this ridge where the Japanese have been embedded. You know how they were embedded into these islands. And so the first time that his infantry goes over the ridge, I mean, there's a lot of injuries and casualties. So Desmond Doss is not that big of a guy. Spends almost 2 days finding these wounded, dragging them to the edge of the ledge, lowering them by rope to medics below. His hands are literally torn to shreds, his arms and his shoulders ache, and he talks about a divine power that gave him the ability to move these men and to lower them, that he does not know where it came from, but from the Lord. And also the protection that he received, because the Japanese were constantly searching, but he never got located, and was able to save 75 lives. Okay? Because of the Declaration of Independence that Jesus made 2,000 years ago, which said, these spiritual truths are now amongst you. Use them wisely and effectively. So like this intern pastor, like Clavius, like Desmond Doss, we are called to be warriors for Christ. There's a lot of darkness in this country that needs to be dealt with in a Christ-like manner. And that's what we're called to do. The prophet Isaiah spoke about the yoke that's going to be broken. That's the declaration that Jesus made of independence. And then the apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians says, there's a new spirit among you, that only those who believe in that spirit can see it at work in their lives and in the world around them. So we're called to be disciples of Jesus, warriors for Christ, to pursue his kingdom. Please rise. Lord, we just thank you again for Jesus making that declaration through the Sermon on the Mount, so that we can experience spiritual freedom, power over sin, death, and the devil, and eternal joy that only you can give. In the Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
believe in God the Father, God the Son, and the God the Holy Spirit. I am part of the fellowship of the unashamed. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of His, and I won't look back. Let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I am done and finished with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed visions, mundane talking, cheap living, and dwarf goals. I live by faith, lean on His presence, walk by patience, lift by prayer, and labor by the Holy Spirit power. My face is set, my gate is cast, my goal is heaven. My road may be narrow, my way rough, my companions few, but my God is reliable and my mission is clear. I will not be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice or hesitate in the presence of an adversary. I will not negotiate at the table of the enemy. I won't give up, shut up, or let up until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, and preached up for the cause of Christ. I am a disciple of Jesus. I must give until I drop, preach until all know, and work until He comes. And when He does come for His own, He'll have no problem recognizing me. My colors will be clear. Amen.
Church, the community of disciples, grant that we who claim the name of Christ may shine as light into our dark world. Our brother Paul led the church, not by lofty words of human wisdom, but by wisdom born of your Spirit. We pray for those who serve the church, that our pastors, teachers, and those who minister in the name of Christ Forsake worldly knowledge that perishes and be led by your truth. Blessed are those who honor your commandments, O Lord. We pray for our world, for the governments, and for its leaders. May all who rule honor justice and compassion and serve the common good that the people may flourish. And teach us to offer food for the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted. We pray for the sick, the hungry, the poor, the homeless, and those who are oppressed. Let your church minister to those in distress and bear witness to your abiding compassion for all who suffer. To you, O God, we pray through Christ, with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
This time, please feel free to pray openly or silently to yourself.
Lord, I want to thank you for fixing Dan's truck. It took a while, but as usual, you come through.
Father, I want to thank you that David Dean is home with a big smile on his face. And we pray that he may grow and flourish and go out to spread your word in that sense.
Lord, I want to continue to lift up Ray. Lord, he needs strength and he needs his pain to go away. Lord, I ask you to remove this pain, to give him a painless life. And thank you so much for the people who have been here to take away this pain.
Jean May into your care and ask for your blessing on her and let us move on.
Father, I lift up all our youth and our young disciples, and I ask you to let your Holy Spirit resonate in your heart, Father, so that they too can add salt to the life.
Lord, I want to lift up religion person who lost her husband. And just ask you to give peace in the midst of suffering.
Father, I ask that you walk my grandson on his journey back to your righteousness.
Lord, be with Carl and Marilyn and Nicole and Phil. And with my sister-in-law, Audrey, who just finished her chemo treatments. Doing well. And my sister, Terry, for guidance. And all these things we lift up to you in his precious name.
Amen.
The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated and come forward to the usher's direction, please.
I am the bread of life.
Please rise. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep in his grace, truth, and love.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.